Stand. Jacob Bestebroer was born on January 30th, 1969, right here in Chilliwack, British Columbia. He died on September 18th, 2019 at Abbotsford Regional Hospital in Abbotsford, BC. He was 50 years old. Friends and family, good afternoon. And on behalf of Jacob's family and his church family here at Cornerstone Christian Reformed Church, welcome to all of you, and thank you for coming today. Friends, we've come here, I think, in a way, kind of for maybe slightly different reasons. For some of you, you've no doubt come here because today you're feeling sad, you're grieving. Jacob was a very important person in your life, and so naturally you're grieving his loss, and if that's you, you're in need of comfort. So if that's you today, I want to say to you, you're very, very welcome here. This time and this place, there for you. Shed tears without embarrassment. Grieve without any sense of shame. Find healing in the stories that we share today, in the community that's surrounding you, and in the gospel hope of eternal life. Now, others of you, you might have come here for a slightly different reason than that today. You're here because you want to celebrate Jacob's life. And in that case, you're in need of some space to rejoice, right? To give thanks for Jacob's life, even for his ongoing life in Jesus Christ. And if that's you today, I want to say to you too, you are very welcome to this place. This time and this place are for you. Smile. Be happy for Jacob. Be happy for his family and for the years that they spent together. Smile. Give thanks for Jacob's role in your life, however big or however small it might have been. And do that with all your heart. Still, some of you, some of the rest of you, you might not even be here so much really because you even knew Jacob that well at all. But you're here because you want to support somebody that did, somebody that loved him. You've answered, whether you know it or not, you have answered the gospel's call to rejoice with those who rejoice and to mourn with those who mourn. And if that's you today, then you too are very, very welcome here. This time and this place are for you. Give hugs like your arms are the very arms of Jesus Christ. You know, share words of encouragement and hope and joy like your words are the very words of God. Wipe away tears. But you know, I suspect that most of us are probably here in a way for all of those reasons. We're here because we want to do all three. We want to grieve, we want to celebrate, and we want to support. And if that's you, you too are welcome. Cry and laugh and love and do it all. And the reason that we can do all that, here it is. I want to read for you something. It's question and answer number one from something called the Heidelberg Catechism. Many of you won't know what that is, but the Heidelberg Catechism is kind of one of what we would call the chief confessional documents of this church, the Christian Reformed Church. It's a kind of summary of what the Bible teaches in what I would call a question and answer format. And this is what it says. The first question and answer go like this. The question is, what is my only comfort in life and in death? And the answer is that I'm not my own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He's fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood, and he set me free from the power of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Friends and family, let's pray together as we open this service. Loving and merciful God and Father, you're nearest to us when we need you the most. And so in this time of sorrow, Father, we turn to you, knowing that you love us, trusting in your perfect wisdom. And we thank you for the gift of Jacob Bestebroer, for his life, God, for the joy that he brought so many, for the love that he shared with his friends and especially his family. Father, for the precious memories that will live on in our hearts. But we give you thanks, especially for the assurance to know that Jacob is continuing his life forever in the joy and the peace and goodness of your eternal presence. May we this day as we gather here, may we draw comfort from this truth and also be enabled to celebrate his life, a life that was good, a life that was decent, a life that was giving, a life lived before you and in light of the grace of Jesus Christ. And it's through his name that we pray all these things. Amen. Well, friends and family members, I'd like to invite you to stand now and receive the Lord's greeting to this place. So would you stand with me? God's greeting. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior. Amen. So friends and family, let's remain standing as we sing a song of God's comfort and peace in the midst of difficulty. We're going to sing together, When Peace Like a River.
Attendeth my way when so.
seated. So where do you go in the face of difficulty and pain and grief? Well, the place that I go to most often is to the Bible, to hear again and again God's words of comfort and hope that he gives us there. I want to read for you a number of scripture passages that I hope can give you some hope and comfort today. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Isaiah 41. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. For I am the Lord your God who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. And from the New Testament, from Paul's letter to the Romans chapter 8, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I'm going to the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 21. This is John's vision. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Friends, let's pray together. Father, what comfort we glean from these promises in Scripture. Jesus is indeed making everything new already now. Already he's steering us toward that vision of heaven. What love that shows, Father, what peace that gives. And God, may we hold on to those promises and guide each and every one of us, Lord God, until we reach our final destination in Christ Jesus, in whose name we pray all these things. Amen. Well, friends and family, our God does guide us, even in times of sorrow and grief and difficulty and pain. And we're going to sing together of that guidance now. And I'm going to invite you to stand with me one more time and sing, Guide Me, O My Great Redeemer.
Praises.
seated. The word eulogy, it means good words. And that's what we intend to do now. Jacob was a man who was a gift to those that knew him. And so I want to take this time to ask his niece, Laura Campman, to come up. I think Laura's going to be first and share some good words about Jacob now.
Passed away peacefully on September 18, surrounded by his family at the Abbotsford Hospital at age 50 after a long battle with cancer. Jacob was born on January 30, 1969 in Chilliwack, the youngest child and only son to Anton and Hendrika Bestebroer. Jacob spent elementary years in Chilliwack Christian School and his high school years at Abbotsford Christian School, graduating in 1986. He attended Trinity Western University for a year before joining Milk Maid in Chilliwack, eventually becoming production manager with input in every aspect of the business. When the Chilliwack Chiefs began in 1990, Jacob became one of their most loyal volunteers. As well as billeting hockey players, he proved to have an uncanny knack for stats, which he could pull from memory at a moment's notice. He did radio shows, scouted for the team, and filled in all their capacities where needed. Jacob and Pat could always be seen in the old barn, Section A, seat 29 and 30. It was during one game when the regular color commentator person did not show, and Jacob was asked to fill in, that he found his true gifting. The press box became his new seat at the games. In 2005, Jacob left Seal Test and spent a year in the Chilliwack Archives researching Chilliwack hockey. When the Chiefs moved to Langley and the WHL Bruins came to town in 2006, Jacob's passion then became a career when he joined the team in a professional capacity. When Jacob wasn't doing something for the team, he was busy with his hobby of collecting hockey cards and running a small home-based business, Chilliwack Collectibles. At one point, Jacob had the second largest collection of junior hockey card listings in North America. Everything Jacob did was done with great organizational skills, a touch of perfectionism, and a whole lot of pride. While Jacob is still well known in the community for his passion for hockey, his greatest achievement in life was his long-awaited arrival of his two daughters. His family meant everything to him, and when he took his last breath, it was with Pat, Abby, and Sophie at his side. He is survived by his wife of 26 years, Patricia, his two daughters, Sophie and Abbigail, his father, Anton, his sisters, Margaret and Wally Tenbrinke, Jane and Case Langbroek, Rita and Bert Tenbrinke, Gerty and Ian Shipmaker, and many nephews and nieces. He was predeceased by his mother in 2009. Throughout Jacob's illness, he was surrounded by dear friends and family that were there at a moment's notice. This support did not go unnoticed by Jacob and was appreciated to the very end.
Thank you, Laura. I'm going to call Kevin DeWalde up to the front now. Yeah, Kevin's going to say a few words about Jacob. Kevin is one of Jacob's longest, oldest friends and was best man at his wedding.
If you're wondering who's who, I'm on the left with the lawnmower haircut. Jacob was my lifelong friend. He and I go way back. In fact, my earliest, albeit faintest memory of Jacob was right here in this church. One day, this new kid came into the nursery, and being 8 months older, I was a veteran of the group, so I felt some responsibility to welcome him into the room. He looked a little nervous, but I nodded hello. He gave me a smile, and when they put us in the same crib, we gave each other a high five on a job well done. Well, maybe it didn't happen exactly like that, but there's probably something close. Not too long ago, Jacob and I were reminiscing about our elementary school years. He shared with me one of the most terrifying days of his life, which happened in grade 2. At the end of that school day, his teacher told him that he had to go to the principal's office. Panic set in. And he said that he was terrified, and he's trying to figure out what it was that he had done wrong. He was so terrified that he was going to make a run for the front door because he thought his dad would be outside waiting to pick him up, and they could escape. But no. No, his teacher nabbed him, and off to the principal's office he went. He quickly found out that he was not in trouble at all, but rather, they were so impressed with his smarts that they wanted to move him up to grade 3 and skip grade 2. That was a fateful day in both of our lives, as for the next 5 years, we would either sit beside each other or one behind the other in class. We became inseparable. We ran out together at recess and lunch and always made sure we were on the same team for whatever sport we were playing. We hated being on opposite teams. It just did not feel right. An example of this was a birthday party he had at his house 1 year. The party, of course, had to include a game of road hockey. Well, driveway hockey, I guess, since we were not allowed to play on the road. The teams were Jacob and I versus everyone else at the party. After he ran up the score to something like 18-2, mayhem broke out on the opposing team. There was a high stick, a bloody nose, raised voices, and a lot of chaos. The option to rebalance the teams was not going to happen, so we moved on to the next birthday event. Maybe cake came to the rescue, but I can't remember. But there's no way we could be on different teams. One winter, the pond behind our elementary school was freezing over. Big news. Teachers warned us, do not go out on the ice. It's not safe yet. But Jacob and I had to take a look. And it looked beautiful, like a sheet of glass. Imagine, maybe we could play hockey on the ice and with a puck, we thought. We looked at each other and edged out onto the ice. It seemed fine. A bit further out then. Until we heard the loud crack. The ice gave way and we both slipped into the water. We managed to get out, but I'm not sure if our parents ever knew about that misadventure. Back in those days, our teacher might have made us sit the rest of the day in our cold, wet clothes to teach us a lesson. And since they would have been almost dry at the end of school, we may have forgotten to mention it. It was not like we were never competitive with each other, though. A few years later, word came out that there was a new Christian Junior Hockey League starting up. And being the sons of Dutch immigrants, playing minor hockey was never really an option. But finally, we had our chance to live our dream, and we both begged our parents to let us play. To close out one of our first practices, the coach split all of us into two teams. We were going to do a relay. Skate all the way to the far end of the arena, stop, touch the boards, and race back. Then the next guy would go. Since Jacob and I could barely skate, we were put on opposite teams and had to race against each other. So when it was our turn to go, we looked at each other, and there is no way either one of us wanted to lose to the other. Skating in a straight line was not a problem, but that changed as we approached the end boards. Neither one of us could stop. I mean, we tried, but, well, I hit the boards full on and then was looking up at the rafters as I heard a loud thunk 20 feet away. I picked myself up, but did not look over, it was too close. I got going again, keeping my head down, but I could sense that Jacob was not in my periphery. And then the strangest thing happened. All the skaters that I was skating towards all skated past me to the end boards. He later told me that he remembered hitting the end boards, but then the next thing he remembered was laying flat on his back, looking up and seeing the whole team stare down at him. Jacob's thunk had knocked him out. We may have been like the Sedines on the pavement, but we are more like Bambis on the ice. But as he has shown in the past few years, Jacob was a fighter, and being briefly knocked unconscious was not going to stop his determination to keep playing hockey. We continued to play for a few more years, and yes, we did learn how to stop, but I don't think the coaches ever ran that drill again. And no, we never made it to the NHL. But that love for hockey never left him, and led to his dream job working with the Chilliwack Chiefs and the Bruins. Life took us on different paths after high school, as I went off to college and Jacob stayed in the valley. We remained close, though, and we always picked up where we had left off. It was a great privilege for me to be the best man at Jacob and Pat's wedding, Jacob proudly wearing his Blue Jay socks under his tux. Pat, too, had become a close friend through high school and church, and it was a great blessing when he was best man at my own wedding to my beautiful wife. There could have been no other way. Another fond memory that still makes me smile was the night some friends gathered at Jacob and Pat's home to play the board game version of the TV show Survivor. There was a slight nervous tension in the air, as one thought was on everyone's mind. Will I dare vote my spouse out of the game? Jacob and I looked across at each other, nodded, and we whispered to the other guys, "The women are going first." Once the women were out of the game, Jacob and I picked off the other men one by one until it was just the two of us at the end. And after it was over, we said to each other, "That was too easy." There is no hesitation that this was how he and I would play the game. We did not discuss it beforehand. Just a nod and we knew, a few whispers, and it was over. I don't recall who actually won, but it didn't matter, just that we were the last two standing. I love this memory with him, as it reminds me so much of us growing up together. Quite often, we could be little rascals, and even as married adults, sometimes we still were. Jacob was also a very punctual guy who liked things to be on time. Me, not as much. One time, I was about to hit the highway on my way to visit him, and I texted him, "Sorry, I'm running a bit late. We'll be there at 10:15. His reply, "I would expect nothing else from you, Claude." He had such a dry sense of humor, and I grinned all the way to his home. It has been a tough journey these past few years, and a real privilege to have been able to walk it with him, even in a small way. There is no why, no reason that this happened to him. We live in a broken world. It could just as easily have been me, and I know that he would have been at my side as much as he could have too. I have shed tears, as I know many of you have, and I've wondered what kind of tears they are. Tears of sadness? I am sad, as his passing has left a hole in my life. But my tears usually come when I reflect on these great memories we created. Tears of joy, then? No, that seems too trite. So what kind of tears are they? They are tears of love. Love involves both sadness and joy. Love for a friend who is fiercely loyal, always ready to help, and who will be dearly missed. There's a beautiful passage in the Bible, in Hebrews chapter 12. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us." Jacob's race is over, and as usual, he beat me. When we ran the 100-meter sprint against each other at elementary school track meets, I would pump myself up. At the sound of the starting gun, I would lunge forward, look straight ahead, and just give everything I had. And then, out of the corner of my eye, I would see Jacob a couple of lanes over, pulling ahead. To make it worse, I could swear he was just jogging. I would nearly collapse at the finish line, but I don't think he broke a sweat. I could never beat him in a race. So maybe it is no surprise that he finished the race of life ahead of me too. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. During the last few years, he did just that. Even through his pain, I never heard him complain. Throughout it all, Jacob had a peace with him that is humanly unexplainable, a peace that could only have come from Christ. He continued to shower love on his family, and it was so clear to me how much he loved you, Pat, and Sophie, and Abby. His last words to me were of you. You were everything to him. Nothing mattered more. You truly were God's gift to him. And now, he has crossed the finish line set for him, with a cloud of witnesses that have gone before him, from apostles to family and friends, congratulating him on a job well done. I still have to finish my own race. We all do. But I have no doubt that he will be in my cloud of witnesses cheering me on. And when I cross my finish line, I know that he'll be there to give me a high five and say, "Well done, Claude."
That's a great image. Another one of Jacob's good friends, Barry Douglas, would like to say a few words on behalf, of himself, and I think also the Chilliwack Chiefs organization. So, Barry.
Good job. One more round of applause for Kevin. It was fantastic. It was from the heart, so. Thank you, Pat, for coming to see me at the Chief's office and asking me to say a few words on behalf of his friends and colleagues. I appreciate it. Couple things to start off with. One is I know JB wasn't a real fan of ties, if you know him, so I'm going to loosen my tie with your blessing a little bit, if that's okay, Pete, just for JB, just a little bit, okay? Also, I have a cold, or shall we say a man cold, so please bear with me while I try to get through this. I know if JB was here today in my shoes, he'd get a little creative. So I'm going to do my best to carry on that tribute for him and do my best effort of being a little creative. So raise your hand if JB made you laugh. Mm-hmm. Raise your hand if JB provided you a stat or a piece of knowledge within seconds and you knew it came from his brain and not from Google. Hello. Raise your hand if JB sincerely listened to you while you chatted with him. Raise your hand if you asked JB to help you with something and he took care of it and took no credit. Both hands up for that one. Raise your hand if JB confided in with you, told you a secret, and you know it's still in his vault right now. And raise your hand if JB randomly sent you an audio or video link with some kind of random message or a link, like the one he sent us, the San Diego Chargers fight song. Since JB passed away, there's been an overwhelming amount of posts on social media, as well as texts and emails and phone calls. I'm just going to take a few moments to read a few of those messages that were on social media, as well as sent to myself and to our chief's office, and that I've asked for a few of those as well, that I know JB would like to have read today. This comes from Craig Krause of Global TV in Winnipeg. In September of 2014, I sat in the Prospera Center press box 9 hours prior to puck drop, sweating profusely as I anxiously prepared for the start of my television career. At the time, I had no broadcasting experience, and the Chiefs paired me with JB as my color commentator, a seasoned media veteran who was a British Columbia hockey savant. Long story short, the final horn sounds, signaling the end of the first broadcast. As we both take our headsets off, I turned to JB and I said, "How do you think it went?" JB, no hesitation, "It was fine." Well, it wasn't fine. It was an unbearable, difficult broadcast. But we went on to have a great season and developed an unbreakable bond. A few years ago, JB and I laughed about that moment, and he told me to choose not, he told me why he chose not to give me harsh critique because he saw in my eyes that I knew what the answer was. I often look back at that conversation and his maturity level to filter his response, knowing the power of JB's words. A life lesson to me, Craig Krause, be an encourager, not a discourager. Randy Merkley was the play-by-play guy for the Chilliwack Bruins. Randy posted this. "I have never met anyone quite like you and never will. Your sense of humor was infectious. You always made time for your true friends. You were the most humble person I ever knew. You never took credit." Ross Beebe, a.k.a. Roscoe, who was very, very close with JB as well over the many years. Roscoe posted this. "The RBC in Fort Mac was a memorable trip where we had everybody convinced that Gabe Gauthier's dad was actually Gorgeous George, the famous wrestler." JB and Roscoe had his dad signing autographs as Gorgeous George. "JB traveled with me to watch the NCAA Frozen Four where the two Chiefs alumni, Gabe Gauthier and Greg Keith, won the national championship. On that trip, we watched the Boston Red Sox home and opener with the Jays as well. We were two kids in a candy shop." Mike Olson, he runs a football pool that JB and many of us in this room are part of. Mike said this, "Jacob has been part of this pool for over a decade and at some point has taken our money from us with his football prowess. In all my dealings with Jacob, he was a fantastic individual to be around." Tim Kilbright posted this. Tim says, "I lost one of my best friends today. He gave me the chance to work hockey." Mark Lillycrap, a.k.a. Jeebs, and I saw you here. Mark was away in Italy when he heard of the news and posted this. Florence had my tears today. Jacob was a great friend, and I owe my getting back into hockey because of his friendship. I'll miss the humorous texts, like this team, insert player, team, town is a joke. Swine geese, Claude, was a familiar term as well. Mark has pledged that he won't stop doing the ride to conquer cancer until the disease is cured. Steve Bowen sent over a text to me offering his support and used the word that has stuck into my mind ever since I got that text from Steve. Steve's text to me was, JB was an honorable man, which is hard to find these days. I can't find a better word to describe JB than honorable. Chris Abbott and Dave Mulwinney reminded me of a moment that I'll never forget. The Chiefs have a promotion, or had a promotion, that is called Score 4 for More. Every time we score 4 goals, the fans got 2-for-1 subs. Well, Chris Abbott would play this song, Ballroom Blitz, every time Dave Mulwinney read the PA script. Once during the BCHL showcase in the morning game, they must have ran that clip and played that song 10 times in that game. We're laughing. Later that day, we look on Facebook, and there it is, JB's post, the 1973 music video of Ballroom Blitz, with his own quote, I love to Ballroom Blitz. So JB. Andrea Laycock, obviously has known JB for a long time and is a very, very close friend. Andrea sent me this. JB is a one of a kind and, more importantly, an amazing friend. His quick wit, incredible sense of humor always made him a lot of fun to be around. You never knew what he was going to say. He was compassionate and caring and loved his wife Pat and the girls more than anything in this world. I'm going to miss the random conversations that range from Seahawks football to the latest episode of Saturday Night Live. There's a few more here. Adam Powell, former Chiefs captain, and I know who's listening in from Alaska right now. He posted, on behalf of all Chiefs alumni, while we all mourn the loss of a great friend, father, and chief, it makes me smile that the man upstairs now is the best stat man there is. JB was instrumental in helping shape us young men to the great men we have become. I think it's fair to say if we all end up half as amazing as JB, we'll all live a prosperous life. Thank you, JB, for being a mentor, a father figure, and most importantly, a friend. I love you, and rest in peace. Brian Maloney, our current Chiefs head coach and GM, sent me this. JB was an unbelievable person and had a great hockey mind. I hadn't realized what a great hockey mind he had until we started talking about young prospects. Back when I played there, he was a color commentator on the radio and could call the game but I didn't know if he had the great eye for talent or not. Well, he quickly proved me wrong. JB was a huge reason why the Chilliwack Chiefs have been successful over the past decade, especially in the last 5 or 6 years. JB had a lot to do with bringing the talented Jordan Kawaguchi and Dennis Cholowski to Chilliwack. He was also part of getting Alex Newhook in the league before Alex chose to play in Victoria. Brian finished by saying, I'll miss my wise hockey buddy and his dry sense of humor. Harvey Smeal, former Chiefs head coach and a person I know JB really looked up to, sent me this morning. I have such great memories of my time at JB over the years. He joined the Chiefs family as a fan and quickly became a loved and respected member of not only the Chiefs organization, but all the hockey world. I remember it was like yesterday when JB, Roscoe, and Gary Coop would come on the long road trips to watch our games, the down times we would spend talking hockey past, present, and future. Although Roscoe thought he knew it all, JB would let Roscoe, he thought he knew it all, but in JB's kind, subtle way, still show us he had the right answer and not offend anyone. JB was a very kind, caring man who did not want to offend or show up anybody. Harv goes on to say, the thing with JB was that he never would put anyone down when he was talking about players. He would always find a way to find a good thing to say about with kind words, about people, about players, which is not common in the hockey world. Harv also added, through all the talk about hockey past, present, future, JB always made time to ask me about how my kids were doing. He truly cared about how the kids were doing. As I've been gone for a number of years now, I've heard nothing but fabulous things about JB as a father. JB was such a trusted, respected friend and truly will be missed by all. Pat and the girls, please know that my thoughts and prayers are with you. Finally, Eric Welsh from the Chilliwack Progress. If you haven't seen his article, I encourage you strongly to read that article. It's an amazing and beautiful tribute. Eric also sent me these words, and I want to read them to you today. It took 9 years in cancer to make me realize what a good friend Jacob was. When I first moved to Chilliwack and started the Progress in January 2007, JB was a media relations guy for the Western Hockey League Chilliwack Bruins. It was his job professionally to cultivate a relationship with me, and that's how things started. But I think both of us immediately recognized that we had a lot in common. We were both fathers of children around the same age. We loved football and sports cards, good TV, 1980s wrestling, and we were both stat head types with a long love of sports history. Before JB moved into the radio booth to start doing color commentator and hockey broadcasts, we sat side by side in the press box and talked about so many things that had nothing to do with the game we were watching. Even after he moved up to the radio booth, he still came down and took time to talk to me between periods. He'd say, "This game is junk. Have you started watching True Detective yet?" If I'd been more perceptive, I'd have recognized for earlier that the texts he'd been sending me about the Toronto Blue Jays prospects, NFL podcasts, and Wayne Gretzky cards he bought on eBay were him reaching out to me as a friend, not a colleague. "We have so much in common," I told my wife. "We should be really good friends." Eric added, "I told him so. He agreed, and over the last 4 years, we did develop a deeper friendship. I drove him to the hospital many weekday mornings, and we talked about all the usual things. I didn't ask much about the cancer, and he didn't offer much about it. But I'd like to think he enjoyed 15 minutes talking about anything other than the elephant in the room. Of course, by this time, things had changed. We planned to go to a Vancouver Canadiens game, but it never happened. He wanted to go to a sports card show in Langley in August, but wasn't strong enough to get there. There's no one I'd rather have gone to a Packers-Seahawks game with JB more than JB. There's a lot of regret in death, and I will forever regret the many moments that could have been, but I'll also cherish the moments that were. This last week, I've been thinking a lot about what Jacob meant to me. It occurs to me that on my end, he became more than just a friend. Maybe it sounds weird, I don't know, but I'm thinking JB was the closest I've ever had to a big brother. That's the way I'm choosing to remember him." Eric, by the way, in your story, JB actually liked the BC Lions back in the 80s. He liked Nick Hebler quite a bit, I think, and those guys. So, you know. Andrea, he liked soccer as well back in the day, too. The Whitecaps. Willie Johnson was his favorite player. In honor of our friend JB, my former broadcast colleague, do a quick little trivia. Don't expect you to scream out the answers, but I know most of you know them inside. Starting with an easy one. Who was JB's favorite NFL team? I can hear it out there, the Seattle Seahawks. I was actually at the Seahawks game on Sunday. It rained the entire game, and I can't stop thinking that it was actually the football gods crying for JB's loss. His favorite baseball team? No doubt about it, those Toronto Blue Jays. In particular, those 1992-93 back-to-back World Series champs. JB is one of the few guys I know, maybe the only guy I know, that could name the starting nine from both of those teams in about 45 seconds. Ricky Henderson, Joe Carter, Pat Borders. You get my drift. Who was JB's favorite NHL team? Sorry, not Canucks fans. He loved the Edmonton Oilers, and in particular the 1980s Oilers. He loved Gretzky, he loved Messi, he loved Semenko and Moog and all those legends. He lived for those Edmonton Oilers back then. I really miss those texts and conversations where we'd be naming players from certain teams or sports, and JB would pick those guys out of nowhere, just the random players and stats. It was unbelievable. His favorite Chilliwack Chief? Well, that's a hard one. There's a lot of Chilliwack Chiefs he loved. I'm pretty sure he loved them all. A few guys stood out that he talked to me mostly about. Peter Zerba was a huge one. The Rat, we called him Zerbs. Passwords might be Zerbs a few times there. Chad Nelson was a big one. And Brandon Fleener, I think, is actually in the audience today. Fleener was a huge, huge JB favorite. JB, like a lot of his friends, loved the reality TV shows. I'm sure many of you can relate to the texts you'd get about The Amazing Race, or Big Brother, or Survivor. Who do you think was one of JB's favorite characters of all time? Boston Rob. He referred to Boston Rob a lot in our office over the years. He also talked a lot about Prison Break. We spent a lot of time talking about Prison Break on road trips. Prison Break this and Prison Break that. He loved the chicken leg reference. If you watch the show, you know what I mean. Pat, Sophie, Abby, the entire Bestebroer family, I know I speak on behalf of all of us, friends and colleagues, who are fortunate enough to call JB our good friend. Thank you for supporting him and encouraging him to do what he wanted to do. I know he loved what he did, and because of your support, he did that. We are also proud to call him a friend, and I know JB would be so proud of how strong you all are being right now. In honor of our friend, our brother, former broadcaster. I think it's only fitting that I leave the last words for JB himself. Thanks to Robbie for helping out with this. For one final time, over to you, JB.
I want to thank you again for taking the time for us here tonight. Mark, taking the time to drop the puck. I know it was a last-minute trip for you, but I appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah, it's been great. Been wanting to get out here for a long time and finally made it, so it's good to be with you guys.
The one thing we didn't do before overtime is pick a goal scorer. Yeah. I would not have picked Ryan Forbes, no offense to him, but you just don't think of him as that guy who's going to get the goal in overtime. Full marks to him. He kept it simple. He saw an opportunity to put the puck on the net. That's what he did, and it gives the Chiefs a 3-2 win. I can't explain to you what Jordan Kawaguchi just did there with the puck in the corner, but it was magic. How he got that puck out of the corner to the front of the net, and all of a sudden it was on his backhand.
Tonight. always knew that this day would come. When the journey was over, the battle done. Always knew that the two of us would be one. But we never knew how long. We always knew that our times would end, that our bodies would fail, lose our closest friend. Always knew that on frailty we could depend. But we never knew how long that the parting would feel so wrong. I'll remember you all the days that we had, times that we shared. I'll remember you till we meet again one day. We always knew that our lives would part. How I long to be with you with all my heart. Always knew that the end would come from the start. But we never knew how long that the yearnings could be so strong. Days that we had and the times that we shared. I'll remember you till we meet again. I'll remember you in the eyes of our children as they echo your smile.
Just about a word about the song that you heard playing at the end of that video presentation there. That was a song by a guy named Dr. Steve Mitchinson, and Steve is a palliative care doctor at Abbotsford Regional Hospital, and he gave Jacob and Pat and the girls a CD of songs that he wrote and recorded in the last days of Jacob's life. And this is what he writes about these songs. He says, I have sometimes found myself without the right words to say, the right help to give to those patients and their families approaching the end of life. I've written and recorded some songs which I hope will bring some hope and comfort to those who find themselves facing their own death and to those who are caring for them as friends and family. Now, the songs on the CD is called Giver of Life. And that those songs have become very, very meaningful to Pat and to the girls. And so that's what you heard at the end there. I'm going to ask you to stand now, and we're going to sing together the song, My Jesus, I Love Thee.
I know thou art mine.
Well, friends, before we get to the scripture reading for this afternoon, can I tell you something? I don't really want to be here. I don't. I don't think any of us does. I know Jacob's family doesn't want to be here. What we want right now is to not have to be here, and that means what we want is to have not lost someone, to have not lost Jacob. I think that's what we want more than anything today, but that's not our reality. And so it's good. It's really good, actually, that we're here, that we're gathered here together. Why? Well, because somehow, by remembering and by telling stories and giving hugs and supporting one another, it begins to bring some kind of healing into our lives. Being with each other, it helps. It really does. But you know, as a pastor of a Christian church, I actually think we need more than that too. So, friends, what I'm here to do today is to do my level best to offer some comfort and some hope in the face of this, to hold out some hope for you. Because as I was thinking about it, you know, let's face it, a memorial service. This memorial service, it's not really actually so much for Jacob. I mean, we're remembering him, and we want to remember him well and do him honor and those kinds of things, and we have. But a memorial service is really for those that Jacob leaves behind, right? Those who loved him. It's about you. It's about his friends and his loved ones being able to carry on and to somehow to be able to do that with some kind of modicum of comfort and hope in the face of this tragedy. And friends, the only way that I know to do that is to tell you that there is a God who is bigger than death. To tell you that there is a God who has ultimately conquered death in Jesus Christ, and he offers eternal life. He holds that out to each and every single one of us. Life beyond the grave. Hope for us. And I want to urge you today to reach out to that God. And to accept that promise. To accept that offer. Now, friends, I'm acutely aware, believe me, I'm acutely aware that we all come from different places. We have different backgrounds, right? We were raised in different homes. Some of us have got maybe slightly different values from one another. Certainly, I'd say we probably represent some different faiths in this room. And maybe some of you say, well, actually, no, I don't have any faith. But that's not actually true. All of us have got faith. You've got faith. It might not be in God. It might not be in some greater power or divinity. But all of us have got faith in something. And maybe for you, it's, I don't know, yourself. You know, maybe it's the universe. Maybe it's in human ingenuity. But you know, whatever the case, we all come here today and we've got one thing uniting us. And that's Jacob. And the fact that we've lost him. And listen, here's the thing. Death, no matter the background that you come from, right, no matter the socioeconomic class that you belong to, you know, no matter what faith you believe or anything else, death, it puts us all on the same level, doesn't it? And every single one of us, we've got to admit today that we are powerless to stop it. We can't. Someone once said that there's only one perfect statistic in the world, and that's one out of every one dies. And I know maybe that's a hard reality to think on a day like this, but it's true. And to me, what that means is that then what we have to do is we have to turn somewhere beyond ourselves for some of that hope. Right? We've got to turn beyond ourselves for comfort. And I know for me, and I know for Pat and Sophie and Abby, and so much of the rest of the Bestebroer family, that place and the people of this church, that place is to God. And we go to his word in the Bible. So I want to invite you to read with me. There are Bibles in front of you if you want to follow along. If you don't, that's okay too. We're going to look at Psalm 23 today. It's probably one of the most well-known pieces of scripture. This is what it says there. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of the Lord. Friends, this psalm, what it does is that it gets at something that we need to hear today. Something that's so true that we need in the face of tragedy. Because let's face it, whenever someone dies, right? Whenever someone dies, especially when we lose someone in an untimely manner like we lost Jacob, but whenever someone dies, it's tragic. And it's hard. And it's painful. Right? I mean, to some extent, when somebody passes away at 92 years old, you know, after a good long life, you know, yeah, it's hard, but, you know, it's not the same. But when somebody passes away at 50 years old, with a family still depending on him and counting on him, that hits us in a different way, doesn't it? And then when that happens, and it's really, really painful, I think very, very quickly, we move to asking two questions. And those questions are these: why and where? Why? Why did this happen? Why Jacob? Why now? And friends, you know what? I don't know. I haven't got an answer. I've been a follower of Jesus, a Christian, my entire life. I've been a pastor for the last 16 years, and maybe I'm supposed to have an answer by now, but I don't. I can't see what God is doing through this any more than you can. I don't see the wisdom in it, and I don't see any of it. Any further, I can't see any further than anyone else. And that frustrates me to no end. Because then it just feels like a tragedy, and it's hard, and it's difficult. But, listen, I do have an answer for that second question, that where question, and I think it helps that why question kind of move into the background a little bit. Because the where question is, where was God? Where is God? Where is God in all of this? Where? In this scripture passage, Psalm 23, it helps us to answer that question. Where was God? Where was God when Pat and Jacob and the family heard that kick and the gut diagnosis of cancer more than 3 years ago? Where was God through all of the terrible chemo treatments? You know, where was God when the pain got so bad that he could barely stand it? And the answer to that question, according to Psalm 23, is that he was walking right beside them through it all. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Pat, you and Abby and Sophie, you guys have been walking through that valley for an awfully long time. You have. But God's been with you through it, hasn't he? He has. He's giving you strength when your own strength ran out, right? Giving you peace when it seemed like everything was crashing down around you. And friends, God is there beside us all through every minute of our lives. And in times when our worlds get blown up by tragedy and the very ground beneath us feels like it's moving and it's shifting, when that happens, not only is he with us, but he carries us. He carries us when we're in doubt of his love, when we're in doubt of his presence. He carries us when we're confused. He carries us when we're hurting. He carries us when you don't even believe that he's there. See, friends, what this whole psalm does is that what it does is it outlines for us God's sympathetic and his intelligent care of us, his sheep. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. It's God that guides, God that comforts and protects and walks and even carries us. And then in the New Testament, in the book of John, chapter 10, Jesus is talking to a number of his followers. And he kind of points back to this passage, Psalm 23, that comes in the Old Testament. And he says, you know what, guys? That's me. I am the good shepherd. And his point is that he is standing with them right in their midst. Never leaving them or forsaking them. Never leaving us or forsaking us. Carrying us. Each wounded lamb on his shoulders when the need arises. And I love that about this passage. There's something else I love about it too. This psalm is honest. It is really honest. The psalm doesn't try to say that life is going to be a rose garden. It doesn't sugarcoat anything. And I think Jacob would have liked it because of that. You know, he was a guy that didn't sugarcoat things. He was kind and generous, but he was a straight shooter. What this psalm tells us is that bad things are going to happen. Suffering, difficulty, grief, they're bound to come on our way. It's inevitable, right? Every one of us is going to be disoriented by something that life throws at us. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. And friends, things just don't make sense when you've been living in that shadowy valley of death. Shadows make things dark. And even though there might be all kinds of light up above, for you, if you're in that valley, it's dark, and that's what you experience. And I think that's what most people that are gathered here, most of us feel today. Grief turns our hearts and our minds inside out, and we feel like we don't know where to turn. But here's the thing, the psalm doesn't leave us there. It doesn't leave us in that dark and in that shadowy valley. With that feeling like the rug has been pulled out from under us. It doesn't leave us there. It tells us how things can be reoriented, how things can be turned back and turned right. When death casts a shadow on the psalmist, it says he doesn't fear. He doesn't feel confused. Why? Because he finds comfort. Well, where? He says in the rod and the staff of the shepherd. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Well, how does that work? Well, I think it's like this, right? The rod and the staff of the shepherd, what are they? Well, they're tools. They're tools of protection for the sheep. They're used to fight off wild animals, wolves and bears and other shepherds and bandits. And ultimately what that means then is that they're tools of comfort and guidance. And friends, I don't know about you, but in these kinds of times, when we've lost somebody, that's when I know that I'm a sheep. I mean, it's in times like this that we're stripped of all of this rugged individualism, this deception that somehow we make our own future, that we are masters of our own fate. Because none of us can do a thing on our own to overcome death. But as the writer of this psalm recognizes, God can. Because God is bigger than death. When we're walking through a dark valley and a shadowy valley, the only way that you're going to feel any kind of comfort is if you've got somebody with you who's bigger than the troubles that you face, who is able to defend you. And the only thing bigger than death is the source of all life. Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. The last thing this passage says is surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now that word love that's in there, right? You know that the Old Testament and the Bible was originally written in Hebrew. Well, the Hebrew word for love there is this word chesed. And chesed is really something more like acts of compassion and mercy. Compassion and mercy. These are the things that follow the people that that God loves. Do you know what that word means, compassion? You know where that comes from, the etymology? The word is made up of two words, calm, that means with, and passe, which means, or passion, that means to suffer. And so it means literally to suffer with. So this passage is saying to us that God's compassion, it's coming after us, and that he suffers with us. And to know that in the midst of our pain, we don't have a God. There is a God out there that doesn't just stand far off. He doesn't just stand there watching it happen. That instead there is a God who pursues with compassion. And he gets involved in our lives and he shares our pain. Do you know there's a place in the Bible, in the book of Hebrews, where it tells us that Jesus Christ went through all the suffering that we ever have gone through, only he did it before we did. He knows what it means to suffer. He's gone into the heavenly realms now before us to intercede for us there. That dark valley that we're walking, God himself, Jesus Christ, has walked it before us. He knows what it means to suffer, and he suffers with us, but not just that. Someone wrote a book some time ago. The book was called Where is God When It Hurts? And the answer to that question is, when it hurts, God is on the cross, taking to himself, in Jesus Christ, all of the sorrow and the pain and the suffering of this world. So not only does God suffer with us, in fact, he suffers for us. Jesus suffered in our place on the cross so that God could show compassion and grace and mercy and love, and open a way up for us to know and to have eternal life, to be with him forever. Friends and family, Jacob suffered through the last years of his life. But there in the midst of it all was God's compassion. And in another place in Scripture, it tells us that God's compassion and his mercy are new every morning. They never fail. Even this morning, it was new. Tomorrow, it's going to be new again for you to help you through it. It won't fail. So I encourage you today, reach out for that God that keeps suffering with us and for us and loving us and coming near us and offering us life, eternal life instead of death. This is what gives me hope. A God of comfort, a God who cares. Maybe you think that's a fairy tale. But maybe today you might be able to say, if it were true, it would do. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen. I'm going to invite you all to stand and to respond to God's grace and his mercy and his love by singing with us, There is a Redeemer.
Jesus, my Redeemer.
Just ask you to remain standing as we pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we come before you in this time of mixed emotions, this time when our sorrow and our love flow mingled down because we've lost one that's dear to us. But God, we're glad that you've welcomed Jacob with open and loving arms into your kingdom, into his new eternal home. We're glad that your words to him were words that we all long to hear. Come and share in your master's happiness. Father, it warms our hearts to know that he's basking in your good presence, that he's perfected, that he's whole, that he's perfectly real, that he's cancer-free. Father, we're still grieving here and sorrowing and hurting because Jacob's loss leaves a hole in our lives. And so, gracious God, we ask that you would bind up those wounds that passing leaves, be our constant companion as we live through the days ahead, and teach us, Lord God, the joy and the hope of the resurrection. And we pray all these things through the precious name of our powerful Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, friends, as we lean into the grief today and beyond, know that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, our faithful friend, is there to walk alongside us and to carry our burden for us. And before you leave today with God's blessing, just a couple of quick things here. Please join us for a light reception after the service is complete over across the foyer in our fellowship hall to pass on your personal condolences to the family. And second, please allow the family to exit first before you do. And now take this blessing with you, and may your mourning be turned into dancing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Let's close the service together by singing a song that reminds us of our final destination in Jesus Christ by the Sea of Crystal.